You're on the inside track with Eric Shatzky.
We are fortunate to have a table of deal makers with us today. As you know, Greg Fleming, the president of Morgan Stanley Smith Barney, and Morgan Stanley Investment Management is here. He's shaking things up in those departments. He spent most of his career as an investment banker. And also joining us, Peter Solomon, chairman and founder of the Peter J. Solomon Company, one of the leading independent advisors on Wall Street. Peter, welcome. Good to
Thank
see you.
You
again.
Good to see Greg.
Both you gentlemen have decades of experience giving strategic advice to CEOs. What on earth should American companies be doing with all their cash right now? By some counts, there are $2 trillion of cash sitting on American corporate balance sheets. Should it be for acquisitions? Should it be for hiring, distributed to shareholders? Peter, what would you tell them to do? What are you telling them to do?
All those things. The one thing I'm telling them not to do is repurchase stock. I think they should look for acquisitions if they can. I think they should raise their dividend if they must. And they should hire better people always if they can. There is an enormous amount of cash on the balance sheets, and particularly in the technology area.
Greg, do companies, this is a question that was put to Jeff Immelt of GE not so long ago. Do American companies have a social responsibility beyond their fiduciary duty to shareholders? That they should be doing something with this cash beyond just hiring, say, a few good people. They should be doing something to support the American economy that goes beyond acquisitions, that goes beyond stock repurchases, that goes beyond that kind of thing.
Eric, I think that the best thing that American companies can do for the American society at large is to run those companies well and to generate attractive returns for shareholders, profits, so they can reinvest in hiring people, in generating cash that they can put to productive use. So I think staying focused on that mission is very important and the best thing in the long run.
You believe that too, Peter, that the duty that CEOs have as fiduciaries to their shareholders is consistent with a well-functioning capitalist system?
Yeah, I do. I think they do have social responsibilities. I think they can carry them out a number of ways that are both profitable and responsible. But in the end of the day, a company is supposed to make money.
Should companies consider doing innovative things with their cash, the kind of thing that we're hearing Google and Microsoft are considering, financing a private equity deal for Yahoo? Is that a smart thing? Is that a healthy thing when you hear of things like that?
It depends on what it is. It's all in specifics. Sure, it may be a very interesting idea. Traditionally, companies haven't been terrific being venture capitalists. They should generally leave venture capital to the venture capitalists. But there are times, and the LBO guys have used this very effectively, where it makes sense for companies to warehouse other companies until they're sufficiently profitable to bring them on their balance sheets. So we do have traditions of companies being equity investors or financing of third-party acquisitions, which they don't own 100% of.
Greg, do you think we might see this becoming a trend? Companies stuck with options for their cash. Maybe they're taking Peter's advice and they aren't repurchasing stock. They don't really know what else to do because they can't find anything to acquire that's going to move the needle. So they think about doing things like disintermediating the banks and lending to deals. Is that something you would, if you were back in your old banker's shoes, is that something you would advise a company like Google to consider doing?
You know, I think, as Peter said, it depends on the circumstances, Eric. But I think for the most part, if the economy begins to pick up and markets stabilize and volatility comes down, what you're going to see companies do is put the cash to work on the M&A side of the equation more and more. And that will be driven by two primary things, either secular change in an industry or cyclical challenges that the company's going through. So I would expect, against a positive economic backdrop, to see an uptick in M&A activity. And then at the margin, you'll see creative things like what you're talking about here, but it will remain at the margin for the use of the corporate cash.
But people want to know, don't they, what it's really going to take? Because money is cheap. Right? Interest rates are zero. Okay, there's a spread, obviously, but at the end of the day, it's cheap to borrow. Valuations are low. That's what everybody tells us. Yet we haven't seen deal-making activity return to anything beyond the levels that we saw in 2005, either here in the U.S. or on a global basis. So what is it going to take?
I think it's back to the theme I talked about before. Volatility and uncertainty are brakes on M&A as much as they are on investor activity. So as volatility comes down, as we start having some better sense of where things are going in Europe, we pick up a little economic momentum in the U.S., maybe get some reform out of Washington. I think all of that will lead to the kind of backdrop where you're going to see an uptick in activity.
Peter, is it possible that this cash pile speaks to a bigger problem? You've got the Fed and other central banks pumping tons of liquidity into the market, and there's lots of cash in sovereign wealth funds, corporate balance sheets, excess bank capital. Even investors have cash that they aren't taking risk with. It's just not in the hands of the people who need to have it, the consumers, to start spending money.
Well, you know, the consumer is spending money. Remarkably, the consumer retail sales are better than they should be. I can't quite figure out where that demand is coming from, because concurrently, consumers are paying down debt. What Craig is talking about is you need demand. Nobody invests without a sense of demand. And demand relates to employment. For many companies, it relates to cheap dollar export, demand elsewhere. But to get the economy going, you have to have demand. Demand requires employment.
Peter, if demand begins to pick up and the economy begins to develop some momentum, what specific industry segments do you see potentially being the most active on the M&A front?
Well, you have two that have to be active. One is the pharma business, because they're running out of drugs and they have to acquire new drugs. The other is the technology area, which you saw yesterday. They have to acquire new technologies. It's cheaper to buy new technologies for exactly what Eric says. If you have if you have 40% of cash on your balance sheet relative to market value, you might as well use the cash to buy new technologies. It's easier than hiring people and taking the time, and the technologies are changing so quickly. By the time you hire the people, there'll be a new technology. So the technology companies and pharma companies are going to drive M&A activity.
Peter, great to see you here. We look forward to having you back soon. Sure. Peter Solomon, Greg Fleming sticking with us. Some great stuff from two veteran dealmakers here on the Inside Track. And we've got more coming up after the break. Questions over whether...